Hello, in today's video, we're going to take a look at various vintage Hammond organ amplifiers and some of the things that can be done with them. Specifically, we are going to follow the conversion of a couple of the AO-35 amplifiers, which we see back here in the back. These are the amplifiers which Dr. Z used to in his first design. He actually created the Carmen Ghia amplifier out of one of these amps, and I think he sold those for a long time before he actually started mass producing them under his own name, or under his own builds. He was actually converting these. You know, I don't recommend anymore that people go out and get pristine examples of Hammond organs and strip all these parts out of them, really, because if I'm honest, I think that's been kind of done a lot already, and there are enough guitar amps in the world, and I think at some point we're going to want some of these old Hammonds back. So and they're becoming definitely more scarce. Every time I get on Craigslist and I look for Hammond organs, they're getting less and less prevalent every day, it seems. So, you know, used to several years back, you could get on there and you could get on Craigslist or, you know, some of your local trade papers and so forth, and you would almost always see somebody giving away almost a nice Hammond organ. Just to get it out of their way. You know, most people don't want to move them. If they move house, if they're downsizing to an apartment, once they get old, you know, or if they go into a nursing home, you know, all their things get sold off and the family doesn't want a big Hammond organ, so they, you know, they end up almost virtually giving those away, or they used to. That doesn't seem to be the case quite so much anymore, as a lot of these were stripped for parts and made into guitar amplifiers. Since these were already taken apart, I have no qualms about making them into nice guitar amplifiers. Down here in the front, you'll see a couple of AO-44s. These were used in the Guitologist Pixie designs, which you will see in some of my past videos. I've made a couple of those Pixies now, and I'm real fond of them. They have a real nice sparkling clean sound, and I think a lot of that is down to the preamp tubes that I add to those during the conversion. Over here on the left, far left, you'll see an AO-39, which is a power amplifier that was used in a couple of Hammond models. In order to make this into a really nice guitar amp, you also really need to add another 12AX7 to it as well to get the most out of it. Now, you could convert this as it sits with just the one 12AX7, and you can kind of see it peeking out back behind there. Maybe you can't, I don't know. But anyway, here, we'll get a little closer. But you can see the little 12AX7 back here, and that's the only one that the AO-39 has. It has a pair of EL-84s, just like the AO-35. It has a pair of EL-84s as well, or 6BQ-5As. 5Y3 rectifier. This one has been changed to a 5U4 rectifier. Missing a power tube there, but two 12AX7s in the preamp on the AO-35 makes it ideal for guitar amp conversion, because there's not much that you really have to do to it. Now, we're going to experiment and take a look at some of the various things we can do as far as tone stacks during the creation of our guitar amplifiers, and we may actually make two at the same time, and that's going to kind of cut our production time in half. You know, if we're making one faceplate, then it's just as easy to go ahead and make a second one at the same time, since we already have all of our tools out. So that's something that we're probably going to do here. If that sounds like something you'd like to participate in and enjoy watching, stick around and we'll get a little more into that. Okay, so the first thing I like to do usually before going much further with a project like this is I like to clean the chassis and also clean all the tubes. Basically just give the outside a nice little spick and span. And I use, you know, Dawn dish liquid with a regular rag, and you can see how filthy this one is. If you rewind it a little bit, you'll see how filthy the top of this, the one on this side was. Before I cleaned it, now it's much better. These sit at the bottom of the organs and in the back, and there's a lot of mechanical things going on up above this position where these sit. This one actually had some rust here on the transformer, which mostly came off with a little bit of fine grade steel wool. There was a big thick layer of grease and grime on this. I don't know if it had been stored in a less than ideal conditions, in addition to being at the in the bottom of the back of the organ. But at any rate, it was absolutely filthy. What was down here was grease. And actually, up above, you actually do have to oil the mechanisms in these organs, and that's probably what had gone on here. The oil had either dripped down on the amplifier and accumulated over time, or when they went to move it, they might not have known that, and they tilted it up sideways or something, and you know, it kind of some of it may have spilled out. That's another thing that you need to be careful with if you're moving or messing with these old organs, that you don't spill the oil that's inside of them. And you know, always, if you're going to try to keep one of these as an organ, it's always best to really refer them to a qualified technician. There's a lot of moving parts with one of these organs, if you're not doing something like I'm doing here, which is probably easier than servicing the organ to make a couple of guitar amplifiers, you know, you probably are best to leave that with the technician. But yeah, to get started here, I like to clean everything off. The tubes, you know, they have usually as much grime on them as the chassis do, and I just like to give them a good wipe down. Now, I try not to wipe on the writing on the tubes, because that a lot of the tubes are just printed on the outside, and that will rub right off, and you. You know, unless you knew what this tube was, or unless you know how to identify these easily, then that could pose a problem in the future. So, you know, when you do clean your tubes, just be very, very careful and wipe around any writing or any other labels and so forth. but just to get started, we've got them cleaned up. Now let's take a look at the inside. Okay, here are the guts of one of these examples of the AO-35, and you can see over here how much real estate is taken up by just the power transformer, enormous power transformer. Here's the output transformer here. This is the cap can. Back here we have where the AC used to come in. That's been clipped, and we're going to put a three-prong cord on this, as well as a fuse on the back here. We're going to try, you'll see a lot of these conversions that are done with the controls on this side, and I'm sure the much of the reason for that is, you know, you've got a lot more real estate to work with back here. You also have a nice flat surface back here, so that means you don't, if you use this back side, you don't have to make a faceplate for the amp. But I'm going to try to put the controls on the front of the amp, even though it's going to be a bit crowded. I'm going to try to leave them over on this side as much as possible and keep them on the front of the amp. That's going to shorten all of my leads. That way I can make pretty much everything point to point, and it'll make everything a lot closer. I won't have to run leads to the from the input, you know, which may affect noise on down the line, and we'll see about that. Now I'm kind of two minds. I can see the value in putting it on the back, but at the same time, this is also going to be a nicer looking amp if we can keep it on the front side, because then, you know, you'll be able to see all the nice lit up tubes and everything if you use this as a head. So, again, you know, I'm a bit of two minds about this. And the other argument for putting on the controls on this side is that if you used this as a head with you know, the front covered up, as most heads are, then you would have easier access to your tubes when you reached in the back, because then they would all be on the back side and your controls would be up here. So that would make a bit more sense, and it's a good argument for putting the controls on this side as well. So we'll see. I'm not entirely sold on this thought, but we'll see. I may actually just move the power cord, bring it into the back, and put my controls up here. You'll see a couple of light bulbs here. These aren't for illumination. These are actually for limiting purposes. They are actually tied into a signal input driver. So I think what they're doing is driving the reverb. This was a reverb amplifier. And they were driving the reverb tank, and they're basically going to bleed off any excess, kind of like a compressor, more or less, or limiter. They're going to light up if you have too much, and you'll see these in a lot of, you know, monitor speakers and main speakers. If you open them up, you'll see inside of modern speaker cabinets, even still today, you'll see, you know, little bulbs like this that will bleed off some of the excess signal. And that saves your voice coils and all that sort of thing. And that's probably what these are doing. These are probably taking some stress off of the reverb tank. Everything in here looks pretty much original. All of these caps are still original. There's a Mallory there, and these are all the electrolytics. I will probably replace these. There's one that looks in particularly bad condition. I'll probably replace that one as well. So a few parts that will need to be replaced here. Looks like the easiest thing to do might be to take the screws out of this board and kind of turn the board up on its side, and that might allow me a little better access. But we'll see. These bulbs are going to go anyway. I'm taking those out. They won't be used in the final design, whatever I decide to do with it. And speaking of final designs, you know, there's several different ways we can go with this. The inverter is pretty much already in there and put together. Probably everything from the phase inverter to the power I will leave the same. I'm still somewhat debating that. I've seen a Harmony H415 recently, and you'll see that back in my videos. And if we look at the schematic, and we may compare schematics and see what some of our options are in regard to this, but I had thought about changing the phase inverter to a regular cathode follower phase inverter, and then having an extra tube up front that I could then use in parallel, and even make that switchable perhaps, so that could give me some flexibility, but we'll see, and we'll look at some different schematics and some things that other people have done with these to get an idea of what we want to do with this one. But and tone stacks as well. We're also, you know, we have a lot of options for tone stacks, and we will probably go through those and look at some schematics there as well. So let's do that now. Okay, here is the schematic for the AO-35. Like I was saying before, I think what we'll end up doing is keeping most of the output section and the power section, the power supply. Most of this will all remain. I've seen some people who have made adjustments to the value here on that resistor. And some other small adjustments, but most of the adjustments will be done here up front. We'll probably come in and put like a 68K input resistor or a grid resistor to replace this one. We'll also get rid of these and just put a 1 meg or maybe even something slightly greater than that. I might experiment with something closer to like a 2.2 meg in this position. We'll have to see. We'll probably get rid of this as well, and bias the first preamp tube a bit differently. Some other things we'll do. We'll come in here and put in a tone network, a tone knob, and a volume knob. And the tone knob that we, or the tone stack that we choose, is probably going to be based on something we'll find online. But we'll do a little bit of looking around and see what might suit this best. I know Uncle Doug, whose videos I admire greatly, he does a lot of these sorts of things, or he has in the past. And I think the one that he used was called a moonlight. In this position, I'm not sure what Dr. Z did in their amplifier in the Carmen Ghia. I might check out schematics if I could find them of the Carmen Ghia and see what he had done too, and just maybe use that as some a little bit of direction. Another thing about this particular amp is it has a couple of components here across the output transformer primary. There is a 0.0022 cap and what looks like a 10,000 ohm, a 10K ohm resistor here. These two components together, and let me zoom in on that so you can see that a little better. There we go. These two components here, this capacitor and this resistor together, form what some people call a Zobel network, and I believe it's that is true. It's a type of Zobel network. Essentially, the Zobel network is named after a guy named Zobel who worked at Bell Laboratories, I think back in the 20s or 30s maybe. Who had kind of developed the use of resistors and capacitors in various ways to produce in results, different results. But that's just a really generic name for it. I think it's also called a conjunctive filter when used on this side with the speaker. But from my limited reading, it's really more accurate to call it a Bouchereau cell. Let's take a look at what I mean by that. Okay, this is just a quick look at Wikipedia where it explains what a Bouchereau cell is. And you can see by the diagram on the right over here that this is indeed kind of what we have. We have a resistor and a capacitor in series across a loudspeaker circuit. And you can read here what it says. It's an electronic filter used in audio amplifiers to damp high frequency oscillations that might occur in the absence of loads at high frequencies. I've read elsewhere online that essentially what we're doing is it actually says down here, we are maintaining more of a constant driving point impedance. So from my limited understanding on this, from what I've read, what this does, and this is one of the features that Dr. Z is kind of known for now, since he kept this in his Carmen Ghia and adapted it from the AO-35 original design. And I'm pretty sure it's probably where he got his idea. And I've seen this actually in a lot of old hi-fi equipment, and also in old PAs, like old Bogans, and things like that have these sorts of filters. But essentially what it's designed to do is to keep the impedance of the speaker from spiking too high. So essentially what it does is it kind of keeps everything, it keeps the impedance, more constant, for, I guess, lack of, that's my limited understanding. at least. So that's a Bushiro cell, and you can actually look that up on Wikipedia if you want to read about it a little more. But I think it's more accurate to call it this than to call it a conjunctive filter or even a Zobel network, which is a really generic name for this specific thing. And I just mentioned this because I've seen this on a lot of forums where people are kind of going back and forth about what it is and how it works. And admittedly, I still don't really fully understand it. I have noticed also a lot of people say it acts like kind of a wet blanket over the speaker, kind of muffles things down. And I kind of concur with that because I've experimented before on other amplifiers with removing one of the legs and just letting it hang there on this network to see what happens. And it does seem as if, you know, it's kind of like taking the wet blanket off of things. So, I mean, if it's on some amplifier designs, it might work very, very well. On others, it may not. For guitar, I think possibly some experimentation is in order with removing these. So what I might do in the process, while we're in here, we might remove one of those legs on this AO-35 for these components and just see how it reacts. If it sounds a hell of a lot better after removing them, we might just leave them out. If it seems like it's doing something pretty cool to the tone, if it seems like it's doing the tone some favors, we'll probably leave it in. Now this amp, it's going to be probably somewhat higher gain. So we may need, if we do get rid of this, we may need to compensate with some kind of negative feedback. So, but we'll see what needs to be done. But that's what a Bushiro cell is. Okay, back to practical matters here for just a moment. Here on the inside of the amp, we can see this was the input, and it actually is on the side. We're going to take all of this out and move it up to the front. So we'll have a 1/4-inch input jack up here in the front. We'll also put our volume and tone knobs up front. We will put an indicator light up front. We will probably leave this power connection here on the front of the chassis. Unless it's going to cause some problems, but we will see. I think it's going to be okay right there. So we will leave this little power here, and we'll come in on the back with our cord, run it over to here, and then we'll have our 3-prong cord grounded at this point. So this is where our cable will come in. This is where it will tie. Again, we'll have a fuse in here as well. Probably put the fuse over here in the existing hole. Because there'll be a hole there that will not be used after we pull these wires out. And, you know, with any kind of conversion like this, you're always going to have little decisions to make. I've decided to put this portion on the back of the amp. I will probably just leave all of this here, for at least for the time being. Maybe take out all the screws, but just leave where it was here. And we'll make some decisions later on. I mean, if we want it to look real pretty on the back, I mean, I don't see that as being entirely necessary, but you know, we're going to have a power cable coming in. We're also going to have a speaker output. We have our speaker output already on the back here, but we may move it. There, where this screw is right here, there behind it, there is a little sliver of material here. We might be able to drill into that and put the speaker jack right there. I don't think we're going to be able to use this little plate as a speaker jack. In other words, I don't think we're going to be able to drill into this, remove one of these and drill into it to put a speaker jack here. You know, we'll see. Maybe we can do that. But we might even have to remove this entire plate and then put another metal plate over the top of this and then put a speaker jack there. But these are the decisions we're going to kind of make up as we go along. We might look at some photos and see what others have done to give us some direction on that. But these are the little editorial sorts of decisions that we have to make up front before we can even get started. But I do know this. We are going to put our input here. We're also going to have our volume and tone, our pilot light, and our fuse is all going to be on the front. So knowing that, we can at least get started and drill all of that stuff. One more thing really quickly before we move on. You may be wondering why it is that I chose to put the input jack and the controls on this side as opposed to this side like I had suggested before, closer to the input stage. The reason to put the stuff over here is because if you look at the actual layout of the amps, as you can see over here, this panel is on the side with the tubes, and if you want easy access to the tubes in a head form, you want to be able to reach behind and change tubes easily instead of having to reach all the way in up to the front and change the tubes, it makes more sense to put the tubes on the back side facing rear. So, and also it makes a little more sense too because we have a flat panel which will serve as our face. So that's kind of the, again, you know, you have these little editorial decisions along the way. For some people, it just depends on what you want to do with it. And with these particular ones, I believe both of these are probably going to be in head form. Now, one of these may be going into a combo amp, but even still, it makes a lot more sense to have the controls on that side as well, because the combo amp that I'm thinking of making with this one is going to be hanging upside down inside the amp, so, or inside the cabinet, kind of, you know, tweed style. So, you know, again, these are little editorial decisions that we make along the way, and that's why we're doing it this way. Okay, the first thing we're going to do, there are some components that once again we're going to get rid of. We know we're going to get rid of these limiting bulbs, so we can come in here first of all and just clip these out. We also will not need these resistors that were part of that network. We can clip these out or we can leave them in, either one, but I'm going to go ahead and remove them so it just looks a little bit cleaner when you look in the back of the amp. We'll get rid of those. And there's no need to really be particularly clean about this part, because, I mean, depending on what we decide to do, and the more I look at this, you know, the more I kind of don't like the look of all this stuff sticking on the inside like this. So if I don't come in here and remove these metal pieces, I might just remove this whole plate and put something else over the back. But we'll get more into that in just a bit. Let's see what this wire is. That yellow wire is going to speaker. So that is probably some negative feedback. I'm gonna leave that there for just a sec until I can figure it out. Let's see what we... I'm going to come over here also and remove these wires, the old power wires. I'm going to leave just enough to know which one was black and which one was blue, and that'll give me something to grip on later on when I get my soldering iron too. I'll have something to hold on to while I pull these wires completely off, but just to get those out of my way, we'll go ahead and clip those off. Flipping the amp over, we notice a couple of screws here that are holding on the board inside. We're going to take those out so that we can move that board to the side and get better access to some of the components. So let's take that out. Flip it over. And we should see our board now can move around a little bit. Yep. We may have to clip some components off, but at least now we can get to this screw over here that takes these bulbs out. And we're just going to get rid of that whole bracket. These bulbs probably still work, so I'll probably keep this. I've got a few of these little brackets with the bulbs on them from other conversions, and if they look okay, I'll probably just keep them for the heck of it. Might use them as power indicator lights in some future project, I don't know. We'll see. But they do have independent hookups, so yeah, you never know when you might need something like that. Okay, and things are a bit tight in here, so the next thing we're going to do, we're going to get over here to the input jack and remove all of these components and the input jack included. Let's see, we have a few here. This one needs to come out. But we'll just remove this this whole input jack. We're gonna replace all this anyway, so we're, let's remove all of that. To remove these jacks like this, what I usually end up doing is getting a screwdriver or something else that I can get in here and kind of try to pry. And that helps me get underneath the jack itself. Now you can come in here also and drill out the rivets from the other side. And I'm probably gonna have to do that anyway, so yeah, that might be the best approach. Let's get in here with a drill and we'll draw out those rivets. Okay, we got that piece removed, and after we drilled it out, we still had to come back in here with our hammer and a screwdriver in this manner, and just kind of give it a little whack on each one of those rivets. And when you give it a little whack like that, because they are already drilled out, the rivets should just shear right off, and that's what happened there. So that's how you get those out. Okay, now we are going to come in here and remove these wires. From all of these terminals, so we'll remove this one. Having photographs, or in this case video, is always helpful because that shows us where things kind of went and gives us a better idea. I mean, we can always trace it from the schematic, but this helps us keep track of what we're doing. This one I can just clip down here since that's just going to ground. This resistor that's tucked in here, this is the bias resistor for the output tubes, and it was going to ground through this point. We're going to go ahead and just clip that off. We'll try to leave as much as we can. Maybe we can still use that same resistor. So we'll leave as much on there as we can, and we'll come in with a screwdriver to take this out. So a lot of this initial work is going to be sort of, you know, demolition type work. We're just more or less removing everything and or moving things around. So let's get this little bracket off somehow. This is the Boucherot network right here, or cell. These two components, and yes, that is factory. You can see that in the other AO-35 that I have here as well. Those two pieces, even the way that they are, that's factory. What we might do is have to get those out of the way. We might have to come in with a soldering iron and remove them first, and then get rid of that. But let's get this bracket off. Okay, we've gotten that bracket off. It just took a little bit of twisting with a screwdriver, and then it came right out. So now we're going to remove the rest of these wires from over here, and there's only a couple more left. These are the speaker wires, so we'll get rid of those. This is a little bit of a different video format than some of my other videos. As you can tell, I'm actually going through some of the processes I normally skip. If this sort of thing is boring to you, you can always fast forward to the nitty-gritty. At the end of this video, we will have a sound check as well, so stick around for that. But yeah, we've gotten all these wires by the look of it. Now we're ready to go ahead and remove. Yeah, we're going to have to ground this one as well. So these are little things that we have to remember as we go along whenever we remove something like this, because we removed its path to ground. We're going to have to ground it somewhere else. These always come in handy, these little needle nose, when trying to get wires threaded through. But that needs to go to ground. So, yep. Okay, here we have this terminal rail pulled out, and you know, whenever I take a part like this out, I'm gonna salvage what I can off of it. So I'll take all these screws out and save those in my part drawer. Hardware is too expensive just to throw stuff like that away. You know, I've got 9 screws on here, and I'll take all of those out, save them. But we'll notice down here on the end, we have something labeled switch, and beside it we have a ground. One end of the switch is going to ground. The other end is running with this gray wire, and if we look at the schematic, we will see all of these are labeled on the schematic. They're not labeled here, but we can pretty much presume this is number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, 9 being this one. So numbers 8 and 9, if we look at the schematic, we will see numbers 8 and 9 here, and number 9 connects to ground through number 8, and apparently on some other organ models, this is used as some sort of switch, maybe as a to switch the reverb on and off, perhaps. On this, it's just shorted across, and on the other example of the AO-35 I have here, it's also shorted across. But so we'll just have to remember, in order for this amp to operate, we need to send this gray wire to ground. So we're going to snip the gray wire off and keep it, and later on we will tie that back to ground as well. Okay, we've skipped ahead a little bit, as you can see, and I've gotten all of the controls mounted to the faceplate here. We have an on-off switch, which I decided to put on the front. I did think about putting it on the back and putting the fuse up here, but I've actually thought better of it. I'm going to put the fuse on the back and leave this on the front. We have an indicator light here, tone volume, and an input. When lining this stuff up, I usually like to measure the plate. Find a halfway point and get a straight edge and draw a line, and that kind of gives me something to go by. And then just do some measurements and you know, do some mathematics to try to get these things spaced out in a way that's that looks pleasant when you look at the front. But yeah, that's you know, again, obviously we've skipped ahead, but this is where we've gotten so far. And to make these holes in the chassis, you will, if you do this one of these yourself, you probably will want to go to the hardware store and get one of these step drills or Christmas tree drills bits. You can find these at Harbor Freight pretty cheaply, and they have the cheapest ones that I've found. And this one is from Harbor Freight, and it stood up pretty well for me so far. I've got this one actually, and another set that's like 3 pieces. And I bought both. This one came by itself. You have to buy this one separately. But it's worth it to get both. They also have, if you prefer, if you're doing tube sockets, they also have a hole punch set in there. I think it's like Pittsburgh brand or something like that, and Harbor Freight, that you can get for your, to punch holes in your chassis for stuff like tube sockets. I've tried it in different gauges of material. For some of the heavier gauges, it will bend those, but for lighter gauge and for aluminum, they work pretty pretty darn well and pretty cheaply compared to some of the real high dollar ones, punch sets you can get. So, but anyway, that's just my experience there. I figured I would share. But let's go forward, and oh, one more thing. Here's a piece of material from another project I was doing. I'm going to use this. I'm probably going to cut it down a little bit, but I'm going to use this to cover this back plate and put some screw holes in it, so we won't see any holes whenever we turn this thing around. So it'll at least have something to drill into to put our jacks and whatnot back here, and plus you can't get your fingers in there and get shocked. So we'll do that as well. This stuff is brass shim stock. If you go online, you can find giant rolls of it. I bought a giant roll probably about 2 years ago or something. It'll probably last me the rest of my life. It's so huge. But I use it from time to time for things like shims, or even stuff like this. It does make for nice face plates and things too, if you wanted to cut a piece large enough for an entire face plate. The last project I did that, and it came out pretty well. I thought it looks pretty good. But anyway, yeah, let's move forward. Okay, we have the back off this thing, or we have the cover on here rather now, and we're going to drill a pilot hole for the output jack. And before I drill holes like this, usually you want to check the other side, make sure there's no components in the way when you're no wires or anything that your bit can get wrapped around. And if there's the pilot hole, and then we'll come back and drill our larger hole. Okay, now we have our 3/8 inch bit on here, and 3/8 is the standard size for input and output jacks, as you can see. That's going to get us to where we need to be. Now, a quarter inch, that's a quarter inch jack is what it's called, but that's just the inside dimensions to get to the full dimensions to go through the chassis. You need a 3/8 bit. And you want to just kind of take this slow so you don't make a mess of things. Eye protection is usually recommended as well. So as you can see, there's a lot of sharp shards. Usually I run it a little bit inside the hole to try to clean it up somewhat. Also, when you're done drilling the hole, it helps to have a tool set with some files on hand, such as this, so you can go in here and you can smooth things out. So if somebody ever comes in here and has to work on this amp, they're not going to cut themselves on these little sharp edges. Okay, now we have that hole completely done, and we're going to come back over here and we're going to drill our hole for our cable, and also possibly our fuse holder. Although, what I think I'm probably going to do here in this case is put the fuse on the inside of the chassis. The reason being, fuses, if they blow, usually it's an indication that you've done something wrong. There's some sort of problem that needs to be addressed by tech. If you leave a fuse accessible, that leads to, you know, the potential of somebody just dropping in a huge fuse, which might just burn up a transformer, or putting something in there to short it. So the best thing to do, I have some quick disconnect fuse holders. And I'm going to probably put one of those on the inside of the amp. Here, I'll show you what they look like. And you can get these on eBay. This is where I got this bunch. But these are the quick disconnect type. They'll do the same job, but they're just going to be inside the amp, probably over here. It's going to take up a little less space for us as well, especially on this design. We're kind of running out of space on the back for places where I can put a fuse holder, because standard fuse holders are probably going to get pretty close to this transformer if I try to put one right here, and I don't want to move it over here any closer to any of the input stuff. So we're going to keep everything power-wise over here on this side, and I'm going to use an internal fuse holder. Okay, we have our little rubber retainer grommet in, our hole is drilled, and now we're going to take our three-prong cord, and we're going to strip it back. Here's our three-prong cord. You can get these from Antique Electronic Supply, or other vendors have them as well. Usually what I do when determining how long to cut this back, I figure out where I've got to go with it. I know I've got to at least go that far, so I'm going to leave a little bit of rubber. So maybe we'll come and strip them back to about right here or so. But first thing I've got to do is cut this through the outer sheath so I can get this off. And this is something you don't want to press too hard, because if you slip right here, you can really cut your thumb. I've done this before and cut my thumb. So just a word of caution on that. What I kind of do is just very lightly go around the outside just to get through the outer layer. And then get wire strippers, because these wire strippers don't have something that large, so, but it should slip right off. You see all that talcum powder helps get it off. That's nice. And then we're just going to strip our wires back and get everything ready to be wired up. But yeah, little things like the your power cord and your little rubber grommets and just all the little things, the little hardware. If you don't have it, you're gonna have to have a piece of something to cover up these holes. So if you don't have these sorts of things on hand already, you have to plan for all of this in advance. Otherwise, your costs are just gonna start escalating, because the more things that you forget, you have to reorder. You have to go back and order that stuff, and freight's not cheap. It's best to get everything at once if you can. If you do forget some stuff, there's always, some local stores if you're lucky, so you don't have to order it in through the internet. We're just going to thread things through. Get this in there nice and taut and just twist as we go. Definitely want to have a little bit of slack to work with, because we got to come over here to these little terminals as well. So there's that part. Another thing I like to do on the inside, usually right here behind this grommet, is I like to come in there with a little zip tie, and as you come in here with a little zip tie, and this is gonna help just retain the cable, so if somebody really steps on or trips, and nothing's gonna rip out on them. When you're going to wire these power cords, one thing you want to make sure that you do, you want to make sure that your hot lead goes to the switch first. So whenever you flip the switch, the hot is going through nothing else in the amplifier, so it's going directly to the switch. So the first thing you want it to go is to the switch. Now, the way to determine hot, usually on these cables, it's going to be the black. You have green, which goes to ground, white is your neutral, and black is your hot. If you ever want to test that, you can. You can get your meter out, hold one end to the right hand side of the wall outlet, and right is hot on the wall, and that's continuous. I'm getting a reading there, so that's telling me this pin is going to black, and that is indeed my hot. And again, I want that to go directly to. I want it to go directly to my switch first, before anything else. So there we go. And usually, what I do is I come in here and just wrap everything around first, and then I'll come back and solder it all. You can see our ground is going to this middle terminal, which is grounded. That's kind of cool to have that there ready for us. Okay, the next thing we want to do, these leads for this quick disconnect for the fuse, these are really too long, so we're going to cut these down, and we're going to solder one side to the switch, and then the other side to one of these terminals, and then our other lead, our neutral, is going to go to the other terminal. So let's do that quickly. And I'm not going to leave a lot of lead on these. You probably don't need very much, just enough to pull the thing up and decouple it. So I'm going to say about that much should be fine. Any little bits of wire like that, I usually keep those, because you never know when those will come in handy. Okay, so my camera battery died, so I fast-forwarded a little bit here. I've gotten a little further along. And we can see here we've got everything wired up on the power cable. Here is our fuse right here installed. So all that's ready to go. We've got our output jack wired in. Now we're working on our input. We've got our 1 meg resistor going to ground from here, and what we're going to do is come in here with some shielded cable and go from the input to the grid of the first half of the triode, the first 12AX7. In order to do that, once again, we're going to use some shielded cable. Shielded cable has a cable on the inside. I'm not sure if you can see that from here, but cable on the inside, and then you've got shielding all wrapped all around it. We're going to cut this to length because it has to make it over to here. There were a couple of more components that we needed to remove. These two components were down in there, and we took those out. And what those were the these components here, this little cap to ground, and this resistor here. This resistor, excuse me. We traded for a 47K, so we took that one out and put a 47K in, and now we're going to cut this to length and get it wired in. So let's get our length about right. We don't want to leave too much. What I might do though is leave enough so that I can tuck it down and follow the bottom edge of the chassis here. That's probably a good idea. That'll keep it as low noise as I possibly can. So I think that's going to put me right about there. So the first thing I'll do is peel back the shielding here, and I'm going to leave plenty of room so that I can separate the shielding really well from the actual lead. So essentially what we have here is a little coaxial cable. But, let's strip this back. And here's the shielding all around. What I usually like to do with this is twist it up. On the other end, it's not going to connect to anything. Now, usually what a lot of people do is connect this to ground. They'll ground it on the shielded end and then connect the other end here, and then they're using the ground as the shielding. What I'm going to do, and what's been suggested in a couple of books that I've read before, is I'm going to actually connect the shield portion to the plate of the first triode. I'm going to experiment with that and see what that does. Supposedly that that creates a better shield than ground, even suppresses any noise from getting in. I'm just using a piece of shrink on this end because since we're connecting our shielding to a high voltage source, we definitely don't want that screwing us up. You might be wondering what I'm doing. I'm actually shrinking this with the edge of my soldering iron in the instead of getting a heat gun. What can I say? I'm cheap. Seems to work just fine though. I've actually been doing this a long time, shrink tubing with the edge of my soldering iron. I usually try to get way up here on it though, so if you get down here at the tip, sometimes you get a little bit of solder on the outside. You don't want that, but there, I mean, good as if you'd have done it with a heat gun. And some people are going to go, oh, look at you, you crazy person doing the wrong thing. But I mean, there's a lot of kind of negativity with the in the amp community sometimes. It's like, you know, people be like, oh, you're doing that the wrong way, and probably, you know, in a lot of cases probably I am. They're probably right. But I really don't care. But what I like to do, there's usually some cotton, there's some fabric in there also with that. I like to just burn that out of my way so it's not actually getting in my way, because that stuff will stick out everywhere and you can't really see what you're doing. But what I'm going to do now, I'm going to go ahead and wire this in, and then we will come back to it. Okay, here we pretty much have this thing ready for our first test. We've gotten our pilot light wired up. We have our tone stack all put in here, and we've used a tone stack from that's a clone from like an 18 watt Marshall. There is a website that I'll link in the description that has several different tone stacks that you can use. This is the one that I took from that website, and I will give them credit for that by linking in the description. But this is the tone stack I chose to use, and here it is actually built in. You can see I've tried to keep the wires running to and from it as far away from the output transformer and any of the other stuff as I possibly could. I've actually added another component that was not on the schematic. I've put a 25 microfarad bypass cap on the first gain stage. And what I've found is that by pumping this up early, what this is going to do, this is going to kind of pump up the gain. And by doing this early, you usually have more potential for crunch in the end. So and a lot more bass response as well. So that's kind of what I'm going for, a little more gain and a little more crunch. And that's why I added that to that first 12X7. We could see, let's see what else. This is a negative feedback. Again, going to here. It's coming off the output, off the secondary of the output transformer, and it's tying back in. Let's see. In here, and going to the grid back here, so we're getting some negative feedback from that. I may experiment with removing that. Also, I've seen some examples of these conversions that adjust this resistor downward to like 220K from what it is now, which is 2.2 meg. I'm going to fire this thing up and see why anyone would do that. I would imagine they're trying to get more gain out of it as well, but we will see. I would think that 2.2 meg would be a bit large, but I may even experiment with just shorting that across and not having one there at all. But then again, I'm not sure what that's going to do with our negative feedback. That might be why that's there, to block that negative feedback. So, not really sure. I do know that 2.2 meg seems kind of large for your signal to be going through, which is what it's doing. It's coming out of this plate and coming through this capacitor. Your DC is getting blocked over on this side. Only your AC signal's getting through, but your AC signal's having to pass through this 2.2 meg resistor, and that's got to be possibly dampened down some of your highs. So that might be why that's reduced so much in other designs. Also, I've seen other designs that monkeyed with this value as well. But again, what I might experiment with doing is just removing this altogether and having no feedback, and then removing this resistor as well, and just running it more like a traditional straightforward amp. In my experience, that usually yields the best results for guitar. You get a little more responsiveness from amplifiers that are a little simpler. This, you know, was designed to run reverb and to be really clean and not necessarily to be expressive. So that's kind of where I'm thinking now. What I might do is get rid of this jumper across that to see what that does, and then we'll go from there. Okay, we're ready to start bringing this thing up on a variac for the first time, and We have everything plugged in. Our output jack is plugged to our speaker cabinet. We have our power plugged into the variac, and we're ready to start firing it up. We have our tubes in. The output tubes are mismatched for now. I just grabbed some stuff that was close and threw them in there for the moment, just something to test it out. So yeah, let's get started. We're gonna start dialing this thing up and see where it gets us and see what happens. I'm gonna dial it up to about there. I don't want to go too far, and we're gonna do some measurements. Okay, we're ready to do some measurements here. I think we have our input at about 30 volts AC. We have our multimeter set on AC, and we're gonna check that. And yes, indeedy do, we have about 28-30 volts AC coming in. So let's look on the other side of the power transformer and see what all's coming out. Best way to test that, we're gonna go over here to our nodes on our CAN capacitor after we switch over to DC. And let's see what's going on there. Let's see, I don't see much. Don't see much right there. Don't see much there either. So, not sure. Let's see, let's come over here to the rectifier tube. Let's see, we're measuring DC. There we go, 75 volts DC. Yeah, sometimes these are a bit touchy, and you have to kind of move them around a bit to actually get a reading. But it can be kind of scary sometimes when you think you should see some volts and you don't see them at first. But yeah, there we go, 75 volts. Actually, I don't think the rectifier is doing anything quite yet, because there's not enough volts coming in to heat the filament on the rectifier. So once we crank it up more, we should start seeing some voltages over here. So let's crank it up a little bit more. Okay, with the camera off just now, I cranked up the voltage to about, oh, it's probably 70 volts or so, up slowly, and started getting some popping. And looked over here at the tubes, and one of the power tubes, this is a Mesa tube. This one was actually, looked like it was arcing on the inside. So we're gonna look at that while I crank it back up and see if we can't replicate that problem. So let's get it slowly back up to, right now I'm about 39 volts. Let's go slowly. I was getting some sound. You could actually hear the pops. Let's see what happens this time. It started happening around here, so we're getting fire. You can see the tube next to it, it's got fire. There we go. Look at that. Lightning going on inside. You can actually hear it. That's interesting. So let's get rid of that. That's obviously not a good tube. Interesting. Before we actually conclude that it's a bad tube, let's swap the tubes around, which is what I've just done. I've put the this is a Hammond Amperex tube. I put it on the bottom now, and I'm gonna put the Mesa that I suspect is bad up here, and let's crank it back up slowly. I'm gonna keep an eye on it, and just for giggles, I'm pretty sure it's that tube, but Let's be positive about it. Crank it up slowly here and see what happens. We should see some fire. Hopefully it is the tube. Yeah, we got fire on the Hammond, so we should see sparks on that mesa any second now. There we go. Yep, it's the tube. Okay, I have a new old stock Sylvania tube in there now, and let's see what happens when we crank it up to that same level this time. Let's kind of go slowly, so if we have any faults, we can crank it down quickly. Everything else looked fine except for that one Mesa labeled tube. So there, we got fire in the Hammond, like we did last time. I'm not sure if we're going to be able to see the Sylvanias. Heater or not. Well, we got fire on the top and the bottom on the Hammond. I'm looking closely at the Sylvania and I don't see any fire in it yet. It's got sound. I've got hum. Yeah, I have a cord plugged in and we are getting sound on the input. It looks like we're about at 80 volts or something. We got our pilot lights blaring. So cool. It's alive. I feel like I should start screaming or something, and there should be storms outside. But cool. I think it's going to be all pretty much downhill from here. We're going to take some readings and maybe do a couple little tweaks, and then we'll get back and see what tweaks we've done. Okay, another interesting thing just happened. With the camera off, I was going to get ready to do a first demo, and this Hammond tube started sparking on the inside. So we're going to, looks like there were some arcs between components. Not sure what's going on with that. I don't think I really even soldered anything or desoldered anything on that socket other than the leads for the pilot light, and they look like they're okay. And they look like they're clean and everything around it. That would be my first suspicion as to what the problem would be. And I don't see any solder blobs or anything like that in there. So let's see if I can replicate that again. Probably not a good idea. I should probably just pop the tubes out and put a new match set in, but I don't want to mess any new tubes up. But let's crank the variac back up and see if I can't make that happen again here. It only happened when it kind of reached full power. I've got a little mark on my variac because the numbers aren't really right on. I've got a little mark on there showing me what full power is, 120 volts. Or what full power is, at least in my house. And that is about it right there. Let's see what happens. There we go, I hear some pops. Something happened. Let's give it a minute. Yeah, I've got light and everything. There we go. Hear that little pop? Little tiny pop. Let's see if we can make it happen. I don't see any red plating or anything like that. That would indicate I've got a problem with caps or something. I mean, actually, I think the caps are going to be fine. I'm just wondering what that little pop was that happened a moment ago.
Don't know if I'm going to be able to replicate that or not. Maybe that was just an anomaly. So, fingers crossed, that's what it was. I guess it could also be a faulty 5U4. I might pop that out and put a 5Y3 in it, since that's what's supposed to be in here anyway. But yeah, let's pick up the guitar again and try to do a demo.
All right, we still got fire on this thing. I haven't turned it off, and we're still at full power. I'm gonna see what it sounds like with a guitar. Got the guitar plugged in. So I don't want to blast everyone out of this house, but the tone pot's backwards, so we might have to fix that. Good Lord. Oh yeah. I don't know if we're gonna have to change any values or not, considering that. I mean, listen to that. That's gritty. And that's not even all the way up. That's at like 6. Now that's the wife stomping on the ceiling. You can hear that. So I think this demo is done. Okay, after thumbing around on this thing for a couple more seconds, I've come to the conclusion that all I'm going to do from here is reverse these leads on this tone knob so that it goes the correct direction, but I think that's all I'm going to do. I mean, look at this. I have this thing cranked wide open. I'm going to turn the guitar all the way up. I mean, it is almost, you can hear a little bit of a hum. But that is my fan on my hi-fi. I can hear it louder than that right now. So, and listen to this. I'm not gonna play it. I'm just gonna hit it one chord. I mean, the signal to noise is really good. I don't know if that has something to do with shielding the input the way I did with the with the plate of that first 12AX7 on the shield. I don't know if that's it, but this thing is dead quiet. There's a little bit of a rustle in the background. If you listen long enough, every now and then you'll hear a little bit of a rustle here and there, but there's really nothing I can do to improve this tone from what I can see from here. So I'm gonna button this thing back down, button the board back down, fix the tone knob. And I think we're going to call it pretty much a day on this thing. This is an amazing amp. I'm gonna go and make sure the tubes are biased. It does have a 5U4, so you know we may have to do some rebiasing on the tubes if we want to stick with that 5U4. I might go back to just the 5Y3. Whatever I do, I don't think any changes from here, no matter how adventurous, is going to improve this tone very much. I haven't got a chance to test it very much, granted, but just from what I can tell, usually I can tell a good amp just by hitting one note, and this is one of those. Wow, that's all I can say so far. And stick around, we're going to do a full tone demo here, probably tomorrow when I can actually crank it, because it's late at night right now. All right, it's a new day, and I've gotten back down here with this thing, and bringing it up on the Variac a couple of times already this morning, and determined we're going to need caps, and I'll show you here real quickly why I think that. Which I pretty much suspected anyway. I mean, this amp I think is, I didn't look at the date codes on anything really yet, but I think it's, you know, early 60s. Maybe about 1960, 1959, something like that.
But I'm up to 78. There's about 80 volts or so over here on the variac. Continuing to bring it up. And you can hear a few little pops. And that's probably the sound of the electrolytics forming. Here's some pops and some low rustling. But when we get up to about house voltage, that happens. So, we know we need caps. Well, unfortunately, I broke a piece of my camera's tripod, and I'm trying to glue that back together at the moment, hoping that will serve me in the future. I'm kind of having doubts about that. I might have to go get a new tripod now. Go figure, the other day I was at Goodwill and passed up a tripod, but I thought I already had one, so why buy a second one? It was really cheap too, should have gotten it. Anyway, we've gotten new caps inside of this amp. The old caps were obviously bad, the electrolytics. I have gone with the type I usually use. And have kind of creatively sort of placed these. One of them I ended up fitting over here and ran the lead direct off of the rectifier tube. I've got a little grounding nub here that actually also served as a nut for that screw, so that worked out okay. Over here I had to do something a bit different. I had to come around over the top of the board, go into the connection here on each one of these eyelets, and then come around to the back side of the board, just making sure to keep everything out of the way, and then grounded them back there in the back. Also went ahead and fixed the problem with the tone being backwards. Also, right now I have disconnected this feedback, just out of curiosity to sort of see what happens. I'm curious. I'm sure you guys are curious too. What the difference in tone might be. So I might get some gator clips on this and just do some quick little sound tests. I might have to wait until my glue dries on my tripod piece before I can do that. But yeah, here in a bit we will hopefully get that all going, and we'll test out the sound. Okay, some more work into this thing, and I've come in here and replaced several more of the caps trying to chase this problem. I actually have been, chopsticking around in here, and it seemed like whenever I moved a couple components they were changing that noise problem we experienced that led me to replace the electrolytic, big electrolytics to begin with. Which it sounded like an electrolytic sort of problem, has the big buzz sound. Sounds like something, that just replacing the electrolytics will cure. In this case, it did not cure that, and I was still chasing this problem when I discovered this. I'll show you. I'm going to turn up the variac here and see if we can recreate the problem, just so I can demonstrate what I'm talking about. Okay, variac's up to about 80 volts. Should do it any second now. Starting to make the popping noise. Okay, there's the issue. Now watch this. When I come over here, I'm going to take the tubes out one by one. Taking V1 out does nothing. Taking V2 out cures the problem. Now let's take this tube and put it in V1 position. So that's the tube that we took out to solve the problem. We put it in the V1 position. and we put the V1 tube in the V2 position. And now let's wait for the problem to recur. We'll see if it does. It might make a liar out of me. Let's pump up the juice a little bit and make it happen. Problem seems to be following the tube. So let's go forward with that in mind. Well, I've made a second one of these AO-35s completed, and to say the least, it is a monster. I've done some edits and pared down, gotten rid of some unnecessary components that were in the original Hammond design, and really formatted this more straightforward for guitar use. And I haven't even gotten a chance to crank this thing yet, but I already know that it's a fire breather. This is the second one that I've made, and making the first one actually made this a hell of a lot easier. It was easier just to have the other one out and reference all the changes that were made there. The only thing I have left to do, actually, I did not have, for whatever reason, I had a missing nut for this. So that's just being held on there for a minute just as a placeholder. But yeah, don't pay any attention to that. I've got to come back in here and wire that up. There are my wires ready to go. But I need to go to the hardware store, I guess, and get a new nut. Not sure what happened to the one that went with that. So either that or I have to order some parts. It's a lot cleaner on the input on the second one. Well, I say a lot cleaner, just it's a little more organized. I actually left the RCA jack in place once again, so I had that actually acted as a terminal. I have a grounding terminal and also something that I could wire my input wires to. And the cool thing about that is you can actually use the RCA jack on the side, because it's still there, and if you ever wanted to plug into that for some silly reason and use this with that RCA jack, you still could. So that's an added bonus of leaving that. That's something I probably should have considered when I made the first one, will definitely do in future revisions of this. But yeah, this thing is, I mean, I've got my guitar set over here. It's on the amplifier. I'll tell you what, right now it's all the way down. I'm just going to nudge it over to like one or something, okay? I'm not even going to crank it all the way up. There's all the way up. But I'm going to turn it all the way back down. Just take it just barely off of zero, okay? And we're going to do the same over here. And already, I mean, yeah. This has to be on what, about one on the volume. The tone does work. It doesn't have a very wide sweep. I think in future revisions of this, I may, instead of using a 500k pot, I may go with a 250k pot. And right now the phase inverter is a 12AU7 instead of a 12AX7. So, I could even squeeze more out of this if I wanted. So, scary, to say the least. But yeah, we're going to get into a demo here, hopefully tomorrow. Okay, here is one final look at the schematic and all the changes that were made. Most of the changes, as you can see, were made to the input area. I have a note here that we shielded the input with the plate voltage of the 12AX7, so that's something we need to note for future reference. We got rid of this component. We got rid of this component and replaced it with a 47K. Actually, in the second amplifier, the one that we're going to hear in a moment, I replaced it with a 68K to try to just tame the highs down a tad. We have a 1 meg resistor to ground that we replaced. We removed this component. We put a 25 microfarad bypass cap to ground there on the cathode of the first triode. We have cleaned up the plate supply voltage, and we have replaced, there was a 1 meg resistor, or it said a 1 meg resistor. These were actually 100K resistors, which is, I mean, way different in the actual amplifier. So we had 100K resistors here. I've omitted a 100K resistor here because the plate voltage was around 55 volts or so, which is really too low for a guitar amp 12AX7. So I have doubled that plate voltage, actually more than doubled it. I've brought it up to about 113 volts by removing this component, this 68K resistor to the cathode from here. Remove that one as well. Over here, there was another cap to ground, and that was, I guess, further smoothing out ripple on this power. I'm really not sure what these do. I need to study more on what the theory is behind that. But I know most guitar amps don't have any of this stuff. They just have one resistor that is your plate resistor, and that's it. And that's what I've done here. I've just gotten rid of all three of these components and left one of the 100Ks. That has brought up my voltage considerably, up to around where it needs to be for a 12AX7, which is 113 volts. So I've done that, left this 0.02 cap, which is our coupling cap, into this 18-watt tone stack. Again, I think on future builds, I will probably adjust that 18-watt tone stack, which again is this stack. And I will probably come in here and instead of a 500K tone, I will use a 250K tone pot. But that is, again, the tone stack that I used. So out of that, we come over here and I've omitted this capacitor, which is in parallel with the other plate resistor. So I just have the plate resistor now. I've omitted this cap completely. I got rid of this completely. I got rid of this feedback entirely. So I removed all three of those components. You'll see other people who revise these amplifiers, who leave these in or change these or monkey with these values, and I just chose to remove them all together because I don't think a tube guitar amp needs them. But now we're going through just a 0.02 cap onto our phase inverter. Also over here, this was a 25 microfarad cap. It was the old original cap, and I was replacing those anyway with smaller, more modern ones. So I went ahead and put a 33 microfarad just to get a little more oomph, a little more bass response out of the back end. This I've circled and made a note here that it was actually already 500 ohms rather than the 1,000. So that was different, actually, already from the schematic. I put a 1.5 amp slow bowl fuse in this position with the in line with the switch, and just drew that out so you could see what the power should look like now. We also added a pilot light as a note down here, but those were essentially the changes that were made, as you see, again, I added the pilot light. The changes that were made, not a whole lot of changes. I'm fairly confident that any future revisions or builds of this amp will be a lot easier since I've already done it a couple times and have this video as reference, and probably will be able to pull one of these off within, I think, 2 to 3 hours. Build time would be about right. So that's what has been done. Now let's finally check out what one of these things sounds like.
Okay, here finally is the culmination of this lengthy conversion process for this AO-35. We're finally in a position where we can fully test out the tone. Everything is done. I have made a couple of adjustments in addition to the circuitry. In the V2 position, again, I've put a 12AU7. Right now there is an RCA, vintage RCA in there. In the first position here, is what I believe is a Sylvania-made tube NOS. We have a pair of 6BQ5, original Hammond 6BQ5s, which were made by Amperex, I believe. We're using a 5Y3 rectifier. You can use different rectifiers with this. You just have to go in and make sure your bias is all correct, but I could drop a 5U4 in this thing and probably even eke out a couple more watts, maybe another watt or so, but I'm going to go with the 5Y3 because this thing is extremely loud as is. I put a volume and a tone once again. Our light is not working because, again, I lost the nut to this particular light, and I don't have any extras on hand, so I have to go find a nut to put on there before I wire that up, so that's why it's not glowing. But yeah, let's check this thing out. Right now, I'm going to try it with humbuckers. I probably should have grabbed a Fender as well, but this will give you at least an idea. I think with a Fender, you know, it would sound really good also, but this will give us an idea. I'm also using a 15-inch Eminence Legend speaker. This is just kind of become my shop test speaker, so I'll just run it through that. Sounds pretty good. And here we are on zero. There we're on about one. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put the volume on about five or so. The tone does work. This is probably not the ideal tone circuit for this particular amp. And I think on future builds, and maybe even on this one, I'll go back in and tweak the values for this tone circuit and try to get that where the sweep is a little more intense from the bottom to the top, because the sweep right now, it only seems to do a lot from about zero to three or four, and then just after that it just kind of stays the same. But we'll just I'm gonna put it on about two or three or so on the tone, and I'm just gonna use my guitar volume and tone to adjust everything. For the purpose of this portion of the video, you'll probably notice on YouTube that the screen is narrowed from earlier. That's because this is an iPhone. Everything else was shot on a nicer upper end Canon PowerShot or whatever their upper end Canon is. But it doesn't have very good compression on the audio, so it tends to distort on audio. So I don't care much for that. I'd rather just do the audio portion through the iPhone. stuff, but you kind of get the idea. Let's see if I got a pick. Hang on. There we go. Here's a pick. Yeah, I play with my fingertips a lot, and if you get into sort of hard rock territory, it doesn't, a lot of times it doesn't work quite so well.
Thank you.
1960s. Hammond AO-35 converted for guitar. If you get a chance to pick one of these things up, you know, I don't recommend going out and tearing apart any old Hammonds anymore. They're getting more and more scarce. But if you find one that's already out of the Hammond, you shouldn't feel too bad, you know, converting one of these for guitar, because they are just absolute monsters, as I think hopefully this demo has shown. I don't know how it's coming across in the camera, but here it sounds like a million bucks, and hopefully that came across. Glad you stuck around to the end of this long video. I know it's been a long one, longer than most of my other videos, but thank you for sticking around. Be sure to subscribe for more videos like this in the future, and hope you've enjoyed, and have a good day.